God love you and I totally unholy and unrighteous? I want you to ponder that tonight as we go through the message. But he does.
Amen.
We know he does.
But
some of us aren't sure. We know it here. We know we're saved. We know that. We know we're forgiven of our sin. But God wants us free, brothers and sisters.
Amen.
He wants us free.
Amen.
He's going to set you free tonight. Hopefully many of you are going to go out of here different than you came in tonight. The title of my message is, The Blood is All-Inclusive.
Amen.
I'm going to say that term several times throughout the service. It won't be rote. It won't be redundant. It won't be boring. It'll be life.
Amen.
I was talking to Pastor Dave just for a couple minutes before we got started tonight. And I'm so glad to be in a place where there's an altar and a pulpit.
Amen.
Many churches today, they've done away with these things, and they're trying to do away with the blood, brothers and sisters. The blood has not lost its power.
Amen.
It will never lose its power.
Amen.
It's the same yesterday, today, and forever. I'm going to talk specifically tonight about some tender issues. Because I've preached this gospel in many places to many kinds of people, mostly the unsaved. And we're afraid to touch things. But we've got to touch them because Jesus came to deliver us from these things.
Amen.
Not only sin, but everything that goes along with it. Many Christians know they're saved, but they're not free. He didn't say we would be free when we get to the other side. He said we would be free now, in this life, and then later, eternal life. The blood is all inclusive. I've seen prostitutes come clean. I've seen homosexuals come clean. I've seen women that were saved. They were born again. They knew Jesus, but they had abortions earlier in their life. And they were bound in torment and guilt, having nightmares. The blood of Jesus is all-inclusive. He took all of that, not just the sin, but all the results and ramifications of the sin.
Amen.
He took it all.
Amen.
At Calvary,
yes.
Jesus Christ made a public show of his grace and example out of these things, triumphing over them. The blood is all-inclusive. I'd like you to pray with me, and then we'll get into this message. Father, I thank you that Jesus is here tonight.
Amen.
That the Nazarene is here tonight. The same Nazarene that walked among the people in Jerusalem over 2,000 years ago walks among us tonight. And if we can but just touch the hem of his garment, we can be free, we can be whole, as the woman with the issue of blood found out. God, I pray for miracles all through this house tonight, that Jesus Christ would set us free. Change me tonight, God. Change every one of us tonight. Let us not go out of here the way we came in. Thank you for that Holy Ghost, though, God. It's already touching tender places in people, already touching sensitivities and bringing freedom. We thank you. In Jesus' name. Amen. You can be seated. He's a mighty God. The blood is all inclusive. If the Lord gave me this over the last several months, it kept coming to me. I preached in the jail on Thursday nights. And I kept telling the guys, week after week, that Jesus not only delivered them from sin, but all the things that go with it. The guilt, the condemnation, the torment, the fear. All of it. He took it. And I wondered why I kept repeating that. But God kept bringing this message to me. And one day, about two or three weeks ago, maybe a month, he said, the blood is all-inclusive, son. The blood is all-inclusive. And I looked up that word, inclusive, and it means including the limit or extremes in consideration or account. Including everything. The blood is all inclusive. It includes everything. He washed it away. He's forgotten it. As if you never did it. You remember it because the devil, the accuser, the brother, brings it back to your mind. But God's forgotten it. I don't know about you, but for a long time I would go to God and say, God, I did it again. I sinned again. I committed that same old thing or those same old things again, Lord. And one day the Holy Spirit spoke to me. He says, what do you mean again, son? Mm-hmm. All right, somebody got it.
Yeah.
What do you mean again, son? Remember, we're talking about a perfect, holy, and righteous God. Omniscient. Knows everything. and yet forgets your sin.
Amen.
Oh, hallelujah. Amen. Man, I couldn't even shout. I just sat there and all, brother. And ever since then, I remember that. If we've repented and confessed a sin, you don't have to say it again. Now, if you sin again, and I know something about besetting sin, I've dealt with it for years. I don't understand it, but he still loves us, sister. Through it all, he loves us and he breaks it through. And some of you are dealing with some of that tonight. You're saved, you're gloriously saved, you love God, and you wonder why these things keep holding on to you. I don't know, Paul said he besought the Lord 3 times to take away that thorn in the flesh. He said, my grace is sufficient. And all I can tell you is keep hanging on and keep going on. Because one day, that freedom will come. One day, that deliverance will come. You will be amazed. You might know it. You might not even know it. All of a sudden, one day, you'll be walking and say, that thing's gone. It's gone. Praise the Lord. It's gone. The blood is all inclusive. He takes it away. He wipes it away. It's comprehensive. Of insurance, the word inclusive means providing broad protection against loss. What does sin do? What did the devil come to do? Steal, kill, and destroy? The devil ever stolen anything from anybody in here? Tried to steal our soul, didn't he? What did God remind Peter or the devil of when he came up against Job? You can have everything but a soul. That's mine. Can't touch it. What did he remind Satan of when he came to sift Peter to test him like we? Can't have his life. I've lost almost everything that you can lose in this life through circumstances and situations. Some of my own doing and a lot of them not of my own doing. But like Job, the Lord gives, the Lord takes away, but blessed be the name of the Lord. Because brothers and sisters, hear me tonight. One day, and probably even in this life, you're going to be paid back. God paid back Job. God paid back Peter. And God told that prophet Joel in the Old Testament, I will restore all the years the locusts have eaten. Some of you sitting here tonight, the devil has stolen much of your life. The plumber worm, the canker worm, the caterpillar, the grasshopper, they've all eaten your crops, eaten your yield. But tonight, Holy Ghost says there's a God in heaven that's going to restore the thing, the locusts of Eden. The blood is all inclusive. From Genesis 1:1 to Revelation 22:21, the blood is the lifeline of all creation. It is the umbilical cord between God and his creation. Leviticus 17:11 says, for the life of the flesh is in the blood, and I have given it to you upon the altar to make an atonement for your soul. The life of the flesh is in the blood. One version says the life of all things is in the blood. And it came to me as I pondered this earlier today. Well, the life of all things is in the blood, then the blood is the life of all things. I want you to think for a minute about blood. How important it is. He wouldn't be sitting here tonight. Brother just tapped his heart. All the issues of life come from the heart. And if the bloodline is cut off, you're dead. You're gone. You don't live. It's not only with men, human beings, it's with animals. I grew up in a country in upstate New York and we hunted. When I was 10, 12, 14 years old, I was hunting. I saw all kinds of animals. And the first thing we did, especially with deer, and when farmers in the neighborhood butchered a cow, it's kind of gory, but it's nothing compared to the gospel. We're talking about blood tonight. We're talking about the issue of blood tonight. The animals had to be bled out. The sooner you bled the animal out, the better off you were. The meat was better. It was more tender. It wasn't as gamey and wild tasting. The life of all things is in the blood. That animal can kick. I've shot deer. Hit him in vital spots, and I've seen him run, brother. I've seen blood so thick on the ground, on dry ground, not on snow, that I could almost run and keep up with the speed. It'd be amazing how long they bled, but there was a time when that blood flow stopped, and a deer would be laying there on the ground for me to find. The life of all things is in the blood. Atonement. Remember, he said,
He has given it to you upon the altar to make an atonement for your soul. I'm going to give a lot of definitions tonight, because another thing I found out in our Christian walk, we lack knowledge. My people perish for lack of knowledge. My pastor's not here tonight, because he's not well. He's been sick all week. But I've learned a lot from this man. He's a few years younger than me, but I still call him one of my fathers in the faith. I have tremendous respect for Pastor Roy Smith. Most of you know him, or know of him. He's been here, preached a few times, probably several times. But one of the, probably the main thing, I've learned a lot from him. I've gleaned a lot from him, just watching his life, watching him pastor, watching him minister, watching him be a husband and a father and a grandfather. But one of the greatest things, probably the greatest thing as a preacher that I've learned from him, is how to study. How to study the Word of God. Rightly divide the Word of Truth. How to go into the Greek and the Hebrew and find out what words really mean. And sometimes we hear words like atonement. We kind of know what it means. We've got a general idea of what atonement means. It means my sins are forgiven. They're washed away. But it means to come or cover with pitch. In the concordance, in parentheses, it says with pitch. And I read that, and as soon as I read it, I don't know about you, what came to me was the ark. The ark. Noah didn't use nails and staples and screws. They probably didn't even have them in that day. Very doubtful. They used pitch. And that pitch sealed Noah, his wife, and his children, and all those animals, sealed them in that ark. And doubly, it sealed sin outside.
Hallelujah.
Yeah. Hallelujah. That pitch is the Holy Ghost. You'll find me saying Holy Ghost because that's what I come up with. It means the same thing as Holy Spirit. So I won't apologize. I catch myself because I hear the term Holy Spirit said a lot. There's nothing wrong with that. It means the same thing. But I'll instinctively say Holy Ghost most of the night. Because again, that's what I was cut under. That's what I grew up with. And somehow I just like it. Because I guess because I was weaned on it. Grew up with it. Strengthened with it. I guess my sister likes it too. That Holy Spirit, brothers and sisters, is that anointing. It's that salve. It's that pitch. It keeps us in the ark with Jesus Christ and that world out. And I was telling Brother Dave earlier that I'd love to see the men and women at the altar. Oh my God, I could have sat here all night and watched it. I had to come to the altar myself. It's so precious. You don't know what you've got here, brothers and sisters. Don't take it lightly. Don't take it for granted. Many churches in this town and across this country and across this world are denouncing this blood that we love. Many so-called ministers, so-called preachers, so-called pastors, I won't call them that. I'll call them liars and deceivers because that's what the Bible calls them. They're denouncing the blood of Jesus Christ. The blood is all-inclusive. I didn't have this in my notes, but it will judge those men one day. The very blood that they denounce, brother, they will be judged by it one day. And more harshly than anybody. There's some wimpy preachers out there. It's not. I do it. It's easy to laugh about, but it's not funny. It is. We should be crying over it. Because one day Joel Osteen is going to give an account. To stand before a nation and preach a false gospel. He's deceived, brothers and sisters. You've got to pray for him. You've got to feel sorry for him. If he does not repent and come to know the God that his father knew, he will perish in hell one day with a greater damnation than any child molester, than any pervert. Read it. It's in Jude. We need to feel sorry for him.